Hi everyone. Welcome back to Kadrite TV channel. On this series, we have taken time to summarize the book 48 Laws of Architectural Consulting, written by architect Kosi Emmanuel Chukwujindu. Architectural consulting in the context of the book refers to professional business activities conducted towards the delivery of architecture-related services. The book 48 Laws of Architectural Consulting crystallizes a universally applicable code of practice for architects that transcends geography, culture, and politics. It is the condensation of tons of private interviews granted by senior consulting architects running thriving architecture firms around the world. While there are plenty books that advise consultants on how to make it big, the 48 Laws of Architectural Consulting stands out as the first universally applicable code guide for architecture practice. Now, without further ado, let's dive in and explore the laws. Law number 1. Get yourself a mentor. Architectural consulting is like a game architects play full-time, all their lives. It involves daily interfacing with clients, the government, contractors, subcontractors, and colleagues toward delivery of an ever-evolving scope of services. It is quite a handful, and anyone planning to participate in this game must start by observing those who are already playing it. This is common sense. Most times the mentorship occurs passively while you work with, or for your mentor. The search for a true mentor figure can be gruesome and they are super busy most times. You may consider rendering pro bono services to senior architects in order to get your skills noticed. A good mentor usually has a flourishing architecture practice, a wealth of experience and a lot of interesting projects in his portfolio. If you get lucky and he discovers you, amidst the tons of formal and informal applications he gets, you must ensure you maximize the opportunity. As a rule, good architects love to work with smart, intelligent, younger versions of themselves, and that person can be you.
Law number 2. Get licensed as soon as you qualify. Getting a practice license places you ahead of others, reinforces your authority in the field as an architect, and improves your overall worth, whether employed or not. It is the only ticket to earning the professional scale of fees. When you work on a project, it's a badge of honor. As with other professions, the prerequisite for obtaining a practice license in architecture would typically include your education, your experience, and your success at a professional competence evaluation examination. Typically, there are large numbers of architecture graduates who possess the necessary academic qualifications to practice architecture but have not bothered to apply and sit for the professional exam and obtain a practice license. Two reasons for this are: 1. The fact that members of such societies do not yet fully appreciate the need to use only licensed architects for their commissions. Instead, the society largely thrives on family and person-to-person referrals. This oversight creates a huge market for unlicensed graduates who in turn naturally become complacent with the status quo, thus abandoning any plans of ever getting their license. And 2. Development control boards do not pay close attention to verify the relationship between who produces a drawing and whose practice seal is on it. This, therefore, provides a loophole, which unregistered graduates usurp tactfully. They simply convince a registered architect to append his particulars on drawings not prepared by them and for which they are not commissioned to develop, in exchange for money or other gratifications. This is a punishable professional misconduct.
Law number 3. Price your services appropriately. As an architect, you're also a businessman. As a natural law, nobody gives away anything truly valuable for free, whether it is time, energy, a product, or some resource. It's always in exchange for something. Just how much then is your input as an architect worth? Too cheap or too high, and you might lose your economy of scale. The question can be answered from many angles. You could decide to measure the architect's worth in terms of the amount of time spent on the job, that is assuming you have a way to calculate that, or in terms of the intellectual ability or expertise required to deliver the work and how readily available it is in a particular location. The type of project, whether high-rise, low-rise, factory, institutional or educational, the scale, its location and who the client is are all common factors that may also influence the architect's fee. So how do you make that perfect decision on how much to charge for a project? And how do you know when to stop the bargain? A fundamental key is to only negotiate on your overall involvement on the project and never the rates, amongst other things. Figuring out exactly where to draw this line makes you the smart business architect that you have been trained for.
Law number 4. It's more about the client than it is about you. Learn to put your ego in sync with your client's demands, as long as they are in line with the articles of engagement. The job of an architect can sometimes be extremely unnerving. Interfacing with other professionals over several meetings, lasting several hours, sometimes days, visiting project sites for supervision work and reporting to the client or his representatives. It's easy to see why the architect can be pushed to the edge sometimes. The process of project delivery could be a trying one. More often than not, the architect's personality is tempted to snap at the client. Once your work is reduced to a game of ego, the client's ego will most likely suffocate yours. When faced with such situation, your first consideration should be this: irrespective of your professional profile or pedigree, you are an employee of the client, and customer is always king. Learn to put your wants in sync with your client's demands, as long as they are in line with the articles of engagement and within the ambits of professional standard. Once you play by this rule, you will succeed in making your client feel like he is in charge, even when he may be ignorantly doing your own bidding. This is because, as we will see in a later law, diplomacy always outwits dissension. Law number 5. Relationships matter most. The architect should take relationships seriously, always considering the future, while striving to deliver top-notch professional services. Your client must know that you are with him for the long haul and that he can trust you each time. When you really can't do your client's bidding, neatly hang it on a scapegoat, a third party who neither you nor him have control over. For example, the bank, the government, the weather, the contract, etc. That way, he feels it was beyond you and holds no grudge against you. Litigation must always be a last resort. Ensure you have exhausted cordial means of alternative dispute resolution, such as arbitration, if such clause was included in the articles of engagement. Always remember, after the settlement, you will still have to live and work with them here on earth. Law number 6. A great public image makes your work easier. The way people perceive you as an architect matters a great deal. When people buy something, it is usually because they either believe the product is worth more than the price tagged on it, or they are in dire need of the product and hence do not mind spending anything to have it. People tend to buy what they think, see, or at least have heard that others have bought in massive numbers. So never make the mistake of appearing needy in public, because by extension of the statements above, clients always usually commission architects who seem to be on top of the game and who they have seen or heard about their awesome projects. Your public image is built by a number of things, including your architectural style, your dress sense, your speech, who people see you with, where you are seen, what you are seen in, and how often you are encountered. It is highly rewarding for an architect to choose the high path in crafting each of these elements. Do not give out an image of neediness or mediocrity. A good way to show your client that you are not needy is to extend benevolence first, where possible, with your own resources. It always comes back multiplied. Be your own artist, paint your own intentional picture every day.
In our next video, we summarize the next 3 laws from the book 48 Laws of Architectural Consulting. Leave your questions or comments about the book in the comments section and click the subscribe button so you'll be notified when we release subsequent videos.